So one day I was scrolling through Twitter and I stumbled over this tweet. If you try HTML tag 22, then opening 22 gets treated as text, whereas the closing tag gets wrapped inside an HTML comment. Huh? And look at the screenshot. How does that make sense? Let's verify this claim. We simply create an HTML file, enter the HTML code test, save it, copy the path of the file, and open it in the browser. And yep, it looks weird. And when we inspect the document, we can see how the browser transformed this. So the opening tag was HTML encoded, the pointy brackets were turned into an LT and GT, while the closing tag got turned into an HTML comment. That is so interesting. So I share this with my colleagues. Is this expected and is this interesting for a sanitizer bypass? As you can see, it was already 9:30 PM, so maybe not the best time to start researching something, but I'm nerd sniped. So I put my other work aside, like working on creating more courses for hex3.io, and I started tinkering. So how could we use this behavior to bypass an HTML sanitizer? To do that, first it's important to understand the difference between HTML sanitizing and HTML encoding. If you have malicious user input and you want to make sure you don't get XSS, you simply have to HTML encode it, meaning turn any special HTML characters into their HTML encoded variant. So for example, opening brackets should be turned into LT, or double quotes if you want to place user input into an HTML tag attribute, you should turn this into quote. I know people still get that wrong, but if you know about it, HTML encoding is pretty simple. Now on the other side, HTML sanitization, that is actually a lot more difficult, because in HTML sanitization, you want to allow some HTML. For example, when you have a rich text editor, that gets turned into basic HTML tags like bold, image tags, or anchor tags for links. But as you know, you can get XSS through JavaScript URI links, so sanitizing HTML code is a bit more complex. But still, maybe your first reaction is, yeah, maybe HTML sanitization requires a bit more coding, but that should be doable, right? It's easy to make sure the href link doesn't start with JavaScript. But then you see this example, browsers doing weird stuff. Let me show you what I mean. So let's add an attribute to our opening HTML tag, foobar, and we reload the page. With document.body.innerHTML, we can then look at the HTML code, how the browser sees it. And the browser converted the opening tag into LT, and our attribute is right there. Now, what happens if we add an HTML tag inside the attribute? Refresh the page, and look at that. We get a large H1 heading, and you can clearly see in the elements that the browser indeed added a real HTML H1 tag. We can also change our testing environment a little bit. Instead of creating an HTML file, we can also directly in the console assign our test HTML string to the inner HTML, and that will then force the browser to render the HTML. And afterwards, we can look at how the browser transformed or mutated this HTML, turning it into an actual DOM tree, and then get the HTML of that one. So basically, this is our input, and this is how the browser mutated it. And you can also see here, the H1 is the only actual HTML tag. Now, if we instead use an image tag, we can see that it really tries to render an image. And with an onError event handler, we obviously also get JavaScript execution. And that is very, very interesting. Just for completeness sake, let's change the 22 tag to a div tag. You can see the output is different. No broken image shows up in the document. And look here at the element tree. Inside the body, there is a div tag with the text test and an attribute. Totally fine, this is what I guess we all expected. But if we change the div back to a 22, you know the output is different. Somehow the tag gets replaced and thus our fake attribute is actually rendered as HTML. And this is basically the whole problem, or the cool behavior that we can maybe abuse.
So if you use an HTML sanitizer, maybe it parses the HTML code and sees a harmless 22 tag. The attribute looks fine as well, just some text inside quotes, and it considers it safe, like if it were a div tag. So it allows this as user input to be placed into the page, but then the browser goes crazy and we actually get XSS. This must be a pretty generic HTML sanitizer bypass, right? So I decided to share my finding with my colleagues. Since discovering the tweet, 20 minutes have passed and I proudly present my proof of concept input that should bypass any basic HTML sanitizer. Now we just have to use it against a real target. And immediately I went for the big end boss, DOMPurify. DOMPurify, a DOM-only, super-fast, uber-tolerant XSS sanitizer for HTML, MathML and SVG. DOMPurify works with a secure default but offers a lot of configurability and hooks. I went for that because it's a very good and maintained library and because it's actually maintained by my colleagues at Q53. If I can bypass DOMPurify, I would be really cool.
So, I clone the repository and in the demo folder I find a basic demo HTML file. I add our XSS test input, being the dirty input. This is then passed to DOMPurify to sanitize it, and we can print the clean output. The clean output is then also assigned to the inner HTML. So can we smuggle our malicious XSS payload through DOMPurify? We open it in the browser and, well, we see an image tag. But if we look at the actual DOM tree, we can see that the on error is missing. So DOMPurify successfully sanitized it. Damn.
But to be honest, that also makes sense. I could have guessed that. You see, DOMPurify is a client-side library. It's used in the browser, not on the server, and that has very good reasons. I talked about this before in the video I made about the XSS in Google search, so check out those videos. But basically, DOMPurify wants to be in the client so it can exactly do what the browser does. It uses the browser's HTML parser. This way, DOMPurify will understand the HTML code exactly like the browser understands it, because, well, it's the browser's parser. This is a huge difference to when you have server-side HTML sanitization, because on the server, you need to implement your own HTML parsing. And if you do not perfectly replicate the browser's behavior, then you can run into mismatches. And to make matters worse, you have different browser engines. So maybe you implement the perfectly same behavior as Firefox, but then a user uses Chrome and maybe Chrome has a super small difference and that might be enough to abuse. So maybe instead of looking at client-side sanitizers, we should look at the server-side sanitizers. There are of course lots of them, so where do we start? Well, recently I audited a Ruby project that used an HTML sanitizer, so I thought about starting with that one.
Here's the repository of it, and luckily it comes with an online demo, so we don't even have to set up a test environment. Let's enter our HTML code and it seems to handle it properly. We can also play with it a bit and see what happens if we try the div tag or a p tag and change the config. When we now compare our 22 tag with a p tag, you can see it seems to be aware of this weird HTML behavior and handles it correctly. Darn. Also, I noticed something else. When I added a proper HTML document in VS Code, you can see the tag and attribute nicely color highlighted. But see what happens when we change the div to a number. Suddenly, even VS Code parses it differently. It seems to recognize that this is not valid HTML. It treats this as text, and this in the attribute is actually the HTML code. So maybe it's time to change my language, because calling this an attribute is wrong. We just think it is, but obviously it's not. This is just text, and then the image is the HTML tag. I know this because after a bit of digging, I found the answer. Here is the HTML specification. In 13.2.2 parse error, we can read, "This specification defines the parsing rules for HTML documents, whether they are syntactically correct or not. The error handling for parse errors is well defined." And here we can find the parse error, invalid first character of tag name, with exactly our example, a tag with a number, here 42. The description also describes that a start tag must start with ASCII alpha, not alphanumeric, so only a letter is allowed. Following characters, so for example H1, there can be a number, it just cannot start with one. You can see here how the error handling is well defined. If you encounter this, this is how you have to treat it. The opening tag is then turned into just text, which means the opening point bracket is HTML encoded, and the closing tag is turned into an HTML comment. So this was never actually an HTML tag. This is HTML text. And this was never an HTML attribute. This was just literally HTML code.
So turns out, this behavior is not actually weird. It's just how HTML works. and I assume most HTML sanitizers that try to implement sanitization correctly, they will follow this spec and handle the case just fine, like the Ruby sanitizer did. Damn. Defeated and maybe a little bit embarrassed, I share my findings with my colleagues. Never mind, totally HTML spec. I should have known that an HTML sanitizer bypass cannot be that easy. Another hour of my life wasted. This is how long it took me from seeing the tweet until my realization that it was failed security research. But of course, you know, there's no such thing as wasted time, because actually we learned again new stuff about HTML parsers and HTML sanitizers. And now we actually know about a weird HTML input that we could use against very naive HTML parser implementations.
For example, if we look up HTML parsing with regex, we find this very famous Stack Overflow question with this funny answer, explaining why you cannot actually parse HTML with regular expressions. But besides this funny response, there are also other answers, for example this one, explaining why it's impossible due to the Chomsky hierarchy. So if you study computer science at university, now your theoretical formal language knowledge can be applied. Anyway, if you read on, there's also an answer offering a basic HTML tag regex. This is the regex I use to match HTML tags. To downvoters, this is working code from an actual product. And if we take this snippet and go to grep.app, we can see that this regex is somewhat commonly used. For example, here in a markdown editor. And if we look at this regex in a regex debugger like debugx, we can see that it matches any character that is not those characters. So clearly it will happily match 22.
So even though we didn't find any actual HTML sanitizer bypass, and let's be fair, it seems like this is something well known already and we just didn't know about it, I still think there is a potential for bugs in some implementations. Certainly it won't be a common thing, but it's handy to know about. And if you find a security bug based on this, make sure to let us know in the comments.
As you know, we are working on an online training platform to learn hacking called hackstree.io. And one big challenge about creating courses for Hackstree is that we don't know what you know and what you don't know. For example, do you already have coding experience? And if you have coding experience, is it in C or in Python? And how transferable is that knowledge? And so when we do some courses about Python, will you be able to understand that code? Or do you need an introductory course to Python? And of course, this translates to all the other topics as well. Do you already have some basic understanding of XSS, CSRF? Do you understand HTTP requests? There's just so much to cover, and that's very difficult to design those courses. And there are two different solutions to this problem. The first one is you have to do something. The first thing is that you need to embrace courses that you don't understand, and you need to embrace topics that you don't understand and try to understand as much as you can. And once you encounter something you don't understand, you ignore it and just move on, or you start researching that topic yourself. This is just reality. You need to be comfortable to research topics on your own. And the second part of this solution is hopefully what we do, because we try to create micro courses, so not massive courses, and we try to organize it on the hexagon map. And the idea is that you can then also stop in the middle of a hexagon and move to a different hexagon and learn that topic. And if you encounter something you don't understand, then jump to another hexagon. And we want to really encourage you to jump around between different topics. And it might sound weird, but sometimes learning something about hardware hacking make something click and suddenly you understand something about web hacking. And so hopefully by you researching topics yourself and the way how we organize courses, we hope we can build a great training platform for you. So go check out hackstree.io.